Hello everyone, welcome to my next video in the tutorial top-down beginner series. And this time I will show you how to make the enemy to shoot at the player. And for this I've added this gun here, and but everything else is the same. So the player is the same, the patrol spots and then the walls here in the scene and here in the game view are still the same. And the enemy with the gun is just a copy of the same enemy we did in the last series, in the last videos, and I added this gun and rotated the arms so that they look like they hold the gun. And the gun is basically just two cubes, and it has this projectile emitter here at the front where the bullet will be instantiated. And then we have our tutorial shoot script here, and in this you need to drag your bullet that you want to shoot. Okay, so let's show you this quickly. Just make this a bit bigger here and then press play. And so the scripts are all the same, so if I shoot, the enemy should hear me, and there it comes and it shoots at me. And put the damage is 25, so after 4 hits the player is dead. And then we instantiate a dead body and it falls over, and because it's also tagged as player, the enemy would still keep shooting at the dead player when it sees it. Okay, so let's it was just one update to the last video where we did the core AI basically. So this is all what we did in the last videos. I just forgot one thing. So because the way we did it, if our player hides between behind the wall here, for example, and then the enemy is on the other side, and the enemy memorizes the player but it can't see the player, it would still keep this distance of 5 units or so and then strafe left and right, but it wouldn't go around the wall to the player because we set the distance to 5 units. So if this is the case, if the enemy memorizes the player but it doesn't see the player, then you can just decrease the distance variable that we use for chasing the player. Okay, so if you then just make the distance to player to 0.5 units, it will force the AI to go around the wall. And so if like this first statement, the memorizes player is true and player's on the other side is false, then we just reset the distance to the player to our original value, which is 10 units or 5 units, whatever you've put in there. Okay, and then this way the AI won't stay behind the wall, also it knows that the player is on the other side and could just around. And I've put it in late update. This means this function runs after everything else is done in this script. It doesn't necessarily have to be here, it can also be in the normal update function. Okay, so but yeah, let's go back to our other scripts. So the shoot script on our enemy gun basically on the projectile emitter. This is all you need for shooting a bullet. Let's make this smaller again here and then the script bigger. So yeah, you need the reference to the bullet, the public game object bullet, so that you have a slot in your inspector where you can drag in your bullet. And then for shooting you need a timer again, so we have the timer shots and then the time between the shots, and the time between shots will be 0.25 seconds. Okay, that's just the way as we use the timer in the last videos. Then we need a fire radius in at what distance you want to start the enemy to shoot at the player, so this is 25 units. And then the force we want to apply to our bullet of 2000. Okay, then we check the distance again from our player position to our enemy position. And if the distance is smaller than our fire radius, then we call our function AI fire bullet. And for this we need to check first if basically the player is in front of the enemy, and for that we just shoot out the raycast. So raycast hit player, and then we shoot it from our enemy position in the forward direction. And we actually use a sphere cast, so it is a little bit bigger and not just a point in space if we would have used a normal raycast. So sphere cast, and then the radius of the sphere 0.25 seconds. Don't make it too big, otherwise the enemy will be able to shoot through walls when it gets too close to a wall and the player is on the other side. And then we have our timer again here. That's a way we did it in the other videos as well. So if the timer shots is already smaller than 0 or equal to 0, and if our raycast hit the player that is tagged player, then we basically create a temporary bullet holder, so game object bullet holder, and then this bullet holder, in this bullet holder we instantiate the bullet. Okay, so bullet holder equals instantiate then the bullet at the transform position and with the transform rotation, and we instantiate basically as a game object. And as I said before in the other videos, don't use instantiate if possible because it's slow. Use object pooling instead. There are a couple of good videos out there on object pooling, how to do this, because currently instantiate is very slow, especially if you have to do things very often. But apparently Unity is planning to change this so that instantiate will be fast, and then you don't have to worry about it soon, hopefully. And then the next line is bullet holder dot transform dot rotate vector 3 dot left multiplied by 90 degrees. I had to do this because of the way I created the bullet in the scene. It was just the orientation is just wrong when it comes out. If you do it correctly in the directly, then you don't need this. And then we access the rigid body of our bullet holder, or of the bullet basically. And then we add the force to our temporary rigid body by in a forward direction, and then multiply this vector with our force. Okay, and then after 2 seconds we can just destroy the bullet again, because it will be, if it's you haven't collided, if it's not on screen anymore, you don't want it to be there indefinitely, so we destroy it after 2 seconds. And then we reset our timer shots to the time between shots, so timer shots equals 0.25 seconds in this case. And yeah, if the first case wasn't, so if timer shots wasn't smaller than 0 or equal to 0 and we didn't hit the player, then timer shots is decreased. All right. Yeah, that's just the same timing structure we used in the AI script in the last video. Okay, and then we need to damage the player, of course. So on our player we end, yeah, so we need a script on our player, and we need a script on the bullet to damage the player, right? So this is the bullet from last time that the player is using with the on impact script. We will basically just use the same to damage the player. It has a rigid body and a capsule collider. So let's open this just to show you very quickly. So this is what it looks like to damage the enemy, right? And we will just use the same basically and apply it to the player. So if you go back here, let's look at the actual enemy bullet here, then there's a script tutorial on impact that I've made, and yeah, let's close the other one here, we don't need it. So yeah, that's all you need basically. So here's the game object impact effect. You could have said if you want an impact effect, and then you instantiate the impact effect at the contact point of collision basically. So this is what of all the stuff in green here, what it does, but I haven't implemented that. But all you need for the very core is basically the damage, and then the void on collision, enter collision, collision. Then if the collision.gameObject.tag is the player, we want to damage the player, and then we just destroy the bullet. Okay, and to damage the player, I've used a public static variable on the player of health. So this is in the tutorial player health script, and then there's a variable health, and we just subtract the damage. You can do this as, you can use public static variables if there's just one instance of this. Okay, so if there's just one player, you can use static variables. If you have more than one players, you need to do it like we damaged the enemy. Okay, you don't use a static variable then. Okay, then on the player script where we have our health, we have the public static float of health with 100 units, and then we have this public game object dead player, so we want the player's dead, we instantiate a dead version of it. And yeah, this line's here, with if the health is bigger than 100, you only need this if you want to pick up health points, so you don't really need this now. But what you need are these lines here. If the health is smaller than 0, we call the function die. And in front of that, you could instantiate some, or yeah, object pool some cool effect if you want. Then in the die function, we just instantiate the dead player at the transform position and rotation, and then we just destroy the game object. Okay. And yeah, if you use object pooling, you would set it, you would deactivate it basically. Alright, let me just show you the dead player again. So it's just a copy of the player. I've removed all the scripts, and I've increased the mass to 5 and decreased the drag to 1, just so that it falls over, or in most cases falls over once it's instantiated, so that it falls to the ground. Okay, that's all there is. So let's delete it again, and then we can just delete the bullet and press play again and test it. So we shoot, and there they come. He shoots, the enemy shoots at us. And we are dead. So yeah, thank you very much. See you in the next video. Hope you enjoyed this. Bye bye.